Good morning to everyone. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to the Sunday TE breakfast session. This is the first session of the year 2022. We call it Sunday breakfast TE session because it coincides with the Sunday breakfast. And this is being conducted under the auspices of Forum of Cardiac Anesthesiologists Bangalore, which is same as Bangalore chapter of IACTA. To begin with, I would like to thank three individuals today. Dr. Belani from Minnesota University. Dr. Belani has been associated with TE workshop from the beginning. I would like to welcome him and thank him for accepting to moderate this session. Second is Dr. Srinivas G, who has been promoted as the head of the Department of Cardiac Anesthesia at the prestigious Sri Chitra Tirunal Institute of Medical Sciences and Technology. I welcome Dr. Srinivas.
Thank you, sir.
And thirdly, I would like to thank Dr. Rajesh Shetty, the lead consultant in critical care for Manipal Hospitals in Whitefield. Thank you, Rajesh, for agreeing to speak at the last minute. I am really grateful to you for that.
No problem. Thank you.
The subject will be lung ultrasound. And I request all the audience to mute their mics till the end. And once the lecture is over, you can unmute and speak up. And you can post your questions and comments on the chat box. With that, I would like to welcome Dr. Belani and hand over the podium to Dr. Belani. Thank you, Dr.
Thank Belani. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Muralidhar, and Happy New Year to everybody. All the faculty as well as the delegates who are attending this session today. And I want to begin by congratulating my good friend, Dr. Srinivas G, a well-deserved position where the head of the Sri Tirunal Institute in Trivandrum. That's one of the most important spots in the country. So well-deserving, and congratulations, a good New Year's gift to you, and look forward to further interactions. And today's topic is ultrasound of the lung. It's becoming increasingly used in the operating room and also in the intensive care and also in the emergency departments. It's a routine training at our place in our educational building where we have a simulation center, and all the residents, we have decided to buy them the small portable ultrasound as a gift, so they can keep it in their pocket and use it every day. In fact, they have one and I don't, so I have to use the bedside monitor. So welcome Dr. Rajesh Shetty. He got his medical school training at Mysore University, and then he went on to get advanced training in physiology and critical care, both in England as also in Australia. And he's currently the director of the intensive care unit at the Manipal Hospital in Whitefield. So welcome, Dr. Rajesh Shetty. Please tell us about the lung ultrasound. And once he's done with his talk, we will entertain some questions and answers from the crowd.
Thank you, Dr. Bilani, for the kind introduction. I'll just start sharing my slide first. We have tried it once, so hopefully it should work without any problems. Just let me know once you are able to see the screen, and then I'll get started.
Yes, we can see the screen.
We can see this. Yeah.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, all. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk on lung ultrasound. I understand this is a TE course, academic activity. Lung ultrasound is probably something slightly different from what you would be doing for the rest of the course. Having said that, lung ultrasound is an important component of any of the patients you'll be looking after. So hopefully whatever we talk today will be useful for your management of patients. So first of all, how the lung ultrasound works. It's a very interesting concept because, as you know, air is a very poor conductor of ultrasound. So theoretically speaking, if you are assessing lung with ultrasound, as lung is full of air, you shouldn't be seeing anything. But fortunately for us, whenever there is any abnormality in the lung, there will be some addition of water or fluid. It may be pneumonia, it may be pleural effusion, it may be pulmonary edema, anything for that matter. And when air and water interact, it produces a very special artifacts. And what thoracic ultrasound or lung ultrasound does is identify these specific artifacts, and based on that, you will make diagnosis, either consolidation or any lung pathology for that matter. We will go through that. The credit for all of this should go to this great man. His name is Dr. Daniel Lichtenstein. He's a French intensivist who identified this phenomena nearly 25 years ago. And he's very, very, very passionate about it. Even after 25 years, most of the things what we know is mainly because of this great man. He has done a lot of research on this area. He has done a lot of publication. He has written books as well. And he goes all around the world teaching his skill. He has come to India as well. So, really great man, and we are very thankful to him. Now, which probe to use? You can use any probe. It doesn't matter. I don't think the TE probe will be suitable. So you will have to use, apart from TE probe, other probe to assess the lung ultrasound. These are the three probes which are commonly used. I'm sure you would be aware of all these probes. This is a linear probe. This is a curvy linear probe, and this is a microconvex probe, we say. And you can even use a phased array probe, what you use for transthoracic echocardiography as well. So all of them, actually, as you already know, they have a different frequencies, and they have a different footprint. And because of that, they have a slightly different properties. For example, this is a 12 megahertz, the linear probe. So the frequency is very high. And because frequency is very high, the resolution will be very good. For best resolution, this is the probe you should be using. Having said that, because frequency is very high, one of the ultrasound properties is that if the frequency is high, the depth it goes will be lower. So this is mainly useful for assessing the superficial structures, for example, the pleura. This one is curvilinear probe or abdominal probe, we call it. This has a frequency of 4 megahertz, which means the frequency is less, so the resolution of the images will be less. But advantages, it can go to the deeper part of the tissues, like deeper parts of the lung. This one is called microconvex probe, and as you can see, the megahertz is around 8, which is in between these two. So probably you can say that this has got best of both. It has got a very good frequency. At the same time, it can assess the deeper parts of the whichever tissue, including lung. Dr. Daniel Lichtenstein, which I described earlier, he has only this probe. He does the whole examination just with this probe. We do not have this probe. Some hospitals may have it, I think. It is very unusual to have this probe. Most of the people will have this probe, definitely because of help with vascular access and things like that. And many ERs and anesthesia department and critical care departments will have this probe as well for assessment of abdomen or for as part of EFAST and things like that. It doesn't matter which probe you use. If you have all three probes, that's great. Use all of them. If you have only one probe, you can still use it. and you will still be able to get you know, good information after patient assessment. Now, how do you hold the probe? There is no definite way to hold the probe. Important thing is the whole footprint of the ultrasound should be approximating the skin. So this is how usually, you know, we hold 90 degrees to the skin, and there is an indicator marker. Usual convention is that it's either directed towards the head or directed towards the right. It doesn't really matter actually, but it's better to have a consistency so that when you're comparing images, it is easier to understand. Now, which part of the lung are you going to assess? There are lots of different arguments about this, and lots of different ways of going about it as well. This is one of the ways. You divide each lung into three different zones, and then anterior and posterior, anterior, lateral and posterior, superior and inferior. So here, each lung is divided into six parts, and you assess all these six parts. What I would say is that I would use ultrasound like I'm using stethoscope. Wherever you are going to put the stethoscope, I would use the ultrasound probe in those areas, because the lung pathology can be any part of the lung, including the most posterior and inferior part. Actually, that is the most important part, I would say, because most of the pathologies will start there. So if you haven't assessed that part, probably you're missing something. So the simple answer is assess all parts of the lung wherever you would use the stethoscope. And this is a classical view of lung ultrasound. This is called a bat wing appearance. Basically here, you're looking through the intraplural space. The probe is put on the chest, and this is one rib, and this is another rib, and this is the shadow created by the rib, because it's the ultrasound is not able to go through the bone, and this is another shadow created by the rib. This is the intercostal space. This is the pleural line, and this is the lung parenchyma itself. This is called a bat wing appearance. This is a normal appearance because of the way it looks. It looks like a bat wing. Then other important finding, which again is a normal finding, is called a lung sliding. Basically, it represents movement of visceral pleura on the parietal pleura during respiration. So this is how it looks. Can you see this line, which is a pleural line? And can you see it's shining and moving? That is called lung sliding. And if it is present, it means the pleural and visceral, parietal and visceral pleura are close to each other, and they're sliding against each other, which is a normal finding. The other normal finding is called A-line. This is the pleura, as we explained before. Can you see the lines here and lines here? They are basically reflection of this pleural line, and they happen at equidistance. Basically, these distances will be the same as the distance from here to the skin. So it is reflected down until the edge of the that window. And again, these are normal findings. If a patient has got A lines, it usually means that the patient has a normal lung. Okay, the next important finding or artifact is B lines. This is again same view, intercostal space. This is the pleura. And I think you are able to see there are some lines coming like this. Okay, and they are moving like this, and they are coming and going as well. Okay, those lines are called B lines. Okay, again, B lines can be normal or abnormal. Usually they are normal if they are few. They are abnormal if there are more than a few. So, for example, isolated B lines more than 7 millimeter apart is a normal finding. And in the dependent parts of the lung, up to 28% of normal patients will have B lines, and that is a normal finding as well. It is abnormal when you see more than 3 B lines on a single scan using a microconvex probe, or we usually use linear probe, more than 6 B lines. If there are more than 6 B lines, it means it is abnormal. Now, B lines are very, very, very useful for assessment of patients because it is very sensitive, and it has got a lot of other advantages as well. So whenever there is any fluid in the lungs, the B lines will come, and whenever the pathology increases, the B lines will increase. And usually, if, for example, pulmonary edema, you will see the abnormality first on the lung ultrasound with B lines compared to chest X-ray. And it is directly related to the severity of the disease. For example, if the pulmonary edema is worsening, you will see that the B lines will increase as well. Similarly, it is very responsive to the improvement as well. For example, somebody has a pleural pulmonary edema, and you have given furosemide, or you have done dialysis and removed fluid, pulmonary edema has improved, you will see that the number of B lines will improve as well. So in this way, it is very useful for evaluating the response to treatment. I understand, you know, I was speaking to one of the faculty, I was in one of the courses in NH itself, who was from USA. In their cardiology department, OPD, they use lung ultrasound. And, you know, the patients with heart failure who come, who need a titration of diuretics, they use lung ultrasound to titrate the diuretics. So the application of this is far reaching, not only in ICU, it can be used in the ward and it can be used in the OPD as well. This is some example of a B-line. This is a slide I have showed you already. Here, there are very few, occasionally you are seeing. So I would say probably this is a normal finding. Can you see here? The B-lines are much more thicker and there are more B-lines. This patient has got pulmonary edema. And this is a significant pulmonary edema. This patient, you would expect that they'll be hypoxic and they will have an increased respiratory rate as well. Can you see here? The B lines are even more florid. It's almost like a sheet of B lines going. This patient has got even more severe pulmonary edema and he will be clinically even more worse. So in that way, the B lines can be very, very useful. Now, there are lots of conditions which can be diagnosed by lung ultrasound. These are some of them. These are classical, I would say, diagnosis you can make with the lung ultrasound. They are pneumothorax, pleural effusion, pneumonia, and alveolar interstitial syndrome or pulmonary edema or ARDS, which will come in this. Okay, first pneumothorax. Now, pneumothorax, as far as ultrasound is concerned, is called diagnosis of exclusion or a diagnosis of negatives. You will have certain features in a normal ultrasound, normal patient. And if those features are not there, you would suspect that a patient has a pneumothorax. You cannot say definitely the patient has a pneumothorax. You can say that the patient doesn't have a normal lung and based on the clinical picture may have a pneumothorax. For example, here you are seeing lung sliding. Lung sliding means parietal and visceral pleura are close together, which means the patient cannot have a pneumothorax in this part of the lung. Same thing, if the patient has got B lines, again, it means the patient cannot have a pneumothorax. So it's a negative sign. Okay. As I explained, the pleural sliding. This patient has pleural sliding, so this patient cannot have a pneumothorax. Whereas this patient doesn't have a pleural sliding. Can you see? It's not moving at all. The whole thing is moving, but the pleura is not moving. So given the clinical situation, this patient may have a pneumothorax. This is another normal finding. Here, what you are doing is M-mode. Through the same view, instead of a 2D image, you are doing a M mode. So you are passing the one ultrasound beam through the pleura, and this is what you are going to get. And can you see that upper part is different compared to the lower part? Upper part looks like what they call it, a C, and the lower part is grainy like a sand, is called a shore. This is called a seashore sign. If you see a seashore sign, it means the patient doesn't have a pneumothorax. Patient has a parietal and visceral pleura close together, and that's why you are seeing C, which is the skin and subcutaneous and intercostal muscles, and shore, which is a normal lung with the border, which is the pleura. Okay, when this sign is dissolved, what you get is called a barcode sign or a stratosphere sign, where there is no C and shore. There is only C. There is no shores to be seen. You are deep in the water, you are deep in the sea, you are in a big difficulty. So this is absence of a seashore sign or presence of barcode sign represents that patient may have pneumothorax. Just to compare, sea and shore, whereas this is a stratosphere sign or barcode sign. Now, there is another sign called lung point. All so far, whatever I've explained about pneumothorax is all negative sign. If they're negative, it means pneumothorax may be present. Whereas lung point is a positive sign. If lung point is present, it means the patient has a 100% specifically, definitely the patient has a pneumothorax. So basically, this is how the lung point will look. Can you see this part of the image? You can see that the pleura is sliding. Whereas this part of the image, there is no pleural sliding. Okay, and there is a junction between the moving part of the pleura and not moving part of the pleura. That junction is called lung point. And if you see lung point, it means 100% the patient has got a pneumothorax. So this is a positive sign. The other advantage of this lung point is, if you are able to see, usually what happens is the lung point will start from the most medial and the superior part. You know, it's a non-dependent entity. And as the pneumothorax increases, it will go laterally. So by looking at the lung point, you will be able to even quantify pneumothorax. So that's another advantage of lung point. If you have, if you are able to see the lung point. Now, where to look for pneumothorax? As I said, it is a non-dependent entity. So in a patient who is slightly supine, I would go to the as superior and as medial, towards the apex of the thorax, towards the superior part of the thorax. Okay, and then you go laterally to see where exactly. So it's a non-dependent entity. So you have to go to the most non-dependent part of the lung or the thorax. Now, next one is a pleural effusion. I'm sure all of you will agree. There is no better imaging modality than ultrasound to identify pleural effusion, because fluid is, the ultrasound waves will pass very easily. It will show as an anechoic appearance, like a black shadow. And even a small amount of fluid, you'll be able to see. Can you see here? This is a pleural effusion. This is liver. This is the diaphragm. This is a collapsed lung. And there is so much fluid. It is black. And advantage, as I said before, I think that's probably slide is not there. Even if there is a 20 or 30 ml of fluid, which may not be seen in the chest X-ray, you'll be able to see on an ultrasound. It is as good as your CT scan. Okay, the next diagnosis you can make with lung ultrasound is pneumonia. Now, pneumonia will look at like a hypoechoic structure, and there will be some pneumonic lung and there will be some normal lung. The junction will look a little blurry, and the deeper part of this pneumonia will be in direct contact with the aerated lung, and that irregular shedded boundary is called shed sign. And if the pneumonia is very, very severe, the liver, the lung will look like liver. It's called hepatization. That is again a very good sign for diagnosing pneumonia. So here is one example. Can you see this shredded appearance? Like it's like a paper bits, white, small bits. This is the shed sign. And this is one of the indications that a patient may have a consolidation. Now, there is one sign in pneumonia which is very, very specific, and that is called a dynamic air bronchogram. This is similar to air bronchogram, what you will see in chest X-ray, whereas, if you see the air bronchogram in chest X-ray, it means 100% patient has got a pneumonia. Similarly, if you see dynamic air bronchogram, it is 100%, or according to this study, 94%, you can be certain that the patient has got a pneumonia. Whereas if a dynamic air bronchogram is not there, it means this is not pneumonia and patient possibly has just a lung collapse or atelectasis. Here is the example. Yeah, that shredded paper appearance you were able to see. Can you see that white thing is becoming more white during inspiration and less white during expiration? So basically, in consolidation, the airways are open. There is no problem with the airway. It's the alveoli around it which has become consolidated with inflammatory material. So air is still going in and out. And this dynamic air bronchogram is happening because air is going in and out. Whereas in atelectasis or lung collapse, the airway itself is blocked. There is no air going in and out. That is also will show this white bends, but this dynamic changes will not happen. And that's how you will differentiate between consolidation and atelectasis. Now, is there any evidence for the utility of lung ultrasound for assessment of patients or for assessing all these diagnoses? This was published in Intensive Care Medicine in 2012, and it was all the experts in lung ultrasound got together and prepared this document. This is called International Evidence-Based Recommendation for Point of Care Lung Ultrasound. The idea was every 5 years they'll get together and they will revise the recommendation, but unfortunately, it's nearly coming to 10 years, this recommendation has not been revised. But at that time in 2012, they had 320 references and they were able to make 73 recommendations. And as I said, every 4 years, actually not five, even 5 years, they wanted to do it, but that has not happened. They classified their recommendation as level A, level B and level C. Level A was the strongest recommendation, where they felt that if some recommendation is level A, the further research is very unlikely to change our confidence in the estimate of effect or accuracy. So there is no need to study that area any further. And they gave level A recommendation for these four diagnoses based on systematic review and meta-analysis they did: alveolar interstitial syndrome, pneumothorax, pleural effusion, and pneumonia. So, basically it means that there is no need to do further studies for these diagnoses. You can be 100% sure that your lung ultrasound will be useful for making these diagnoses. Now, just briefly about COVID pneumonia, because, we are in the middle of pandemic, and in some countries, the third or fourth wave has started already. And in India, we are worried that third wave might start anytime. Lung ultrasound can be very useful in assessment of patients with COVID pneumonia as well. And sometimes, it can make a big difference, especially where, RT-PCR is not available, or it is taking time and you're not sure where to take the patient, or, patient is too ill to go for a CT scan. COVID-19 pneumonia, patients can be assessed with, a lung ultrasound. And these are the usual features you will see: thickened irregular pleural line, subpleural shedding, subpleural consolidation, increased B line. And classically in COVID pneumonia, the distribution will be patchy. It will be bilateral, but it will be patchy. And consolidation of the air bronchogram, you might see if there is a secondary pneumonia. Many patients will have lots of complication. One of the complication is pneumothorax and pneumomediastinum. Pneumothorax, you will be able to diagnose. Pneumomediastinum also, indirectly, you'll be able to diagnose. For example, some patient, you were able to do a transthoracic echocardiography one day. Next day, you see that you are not able to see any window at all. Most likely the patient has developed pneumomediastinum. Now, pleural effusion, I put it in bracket because it is very unusual to see pleural effusion in a COVID pneumonia patients. Some studies have indicated that the incidence is about 20%. I completely disagree. If a patient has got a pleural effusion, it usually means that along with COVID pneumonia, patient has got some other abnormality, maybe in heart failure, or maybe has got a syndromic effusion. It cannot be part of COVID-19 pneumonia. Here, briefly discussing, can you see this pleura and this pleura? This is very thin, whereas it is thick. Thickened pleura is a feature of COVID pneumonia. The next thing is subpleural shedding. At the edges, the COVID pneumonia is a very peripheral sort of a lung disease. The deeper part of the lung might be okay, but the peripheries near the pleura, there will be a lot of abnormalities, that whitish shadows you are seeing. That is called a subpleural shedding. And the more severe the pneumonia, other changes will start developing. And one of the other changes is what is called a subpleural consolidation. Can you see the lung parenchyma? There is a break as if somebody has eaten off part of the lung. That is called a subpleural consolidation. This is also seen in patients with other severe viral pneumonia or ARDS. Basically, it means the patient has a very bad COVID pneumonia. As they progress, you will start getting subpleural consolidation. This is a combination of both the thickened irregular pleura and a subpleural consolidation, again indicating that this patient most likely has got a COVID pneumonia, and he or she has got a very severe COVID pneumonia. And as with other pathologies, when the disease worsens, the B lines will increase as well, and that will happen with the COVID pneumonia as well. Here you have a subpleural shedding, you have irregular pleura, and you have increased B lines as well, again indicating severe COVID pneumonia. The patients who are fluid overloaded, part of managing any ARDS patient, and specifically COVID pneumonia, is to make sure that they are not fluid overloaded, or at least they are kept in neutral balance, preferably in a negative balance. And your echocardiography and assessment of IVC will help. For example, this patient has got a distended IVC. Definitely the last thing I will give to this patient, especially if they are hypoxic, is give fluid. Probably I would restrict amount of fluid, and probably I will try to remove some fluid if possible. As I said, one of the complications of pneumothorax is of COVID pneumonia is pneumothorax, and the ultrasound is very useful, and you cannot do chest x-ray every day. You cannot do CT scan every day, but you can do ultrasound, 3-4 times if required every day. So it's a very useful tool to diagnose pneumothorax. This is the barcode sign or stratosphere sign, which indicates that the patient may have pneumothorax. Now, many of these COVID patients will have a secondary pneumonia. Then they will have consolidation with dynamic A bronchogram. And as I said before, pleural effusion is not a feature of COVID pneumonia, but they may have a secondary pathology as well. and that might lead you into pleural effusion, and you'll be able to assess that as well with lung ultrasound. Now, what are the other uses of ultrasonography? Now that we are using ultrasound for assessing lung, people have progressed further. They have found that it can be useful in diagnosing other conditions as well. For example, some patient who has got a difficulty in weaning, reduced chest excursion, you'll be able to understand from this. Cause for weaning failure, you'll be able to find out. You know, many patients will go into the diaphragmatic atrophy. You can actually measure the diameter of diaphragm and see if diaphragmatic thinning is happening, diaphragmatic dysfunction is happening. And, you know, it can be used for recruitment as well. You know, there is a team in Australia, Canberra, where physiotherapists use lung ultrasound before and after each physiotherapy session. They're able to identify the atelectric lung, as I said before, where there is no dynamic air bronchogram. After the physiotherapy session, they will do the lung ultrasound again to see if the lung is expanded, which is much, much better than a regular chest x-ray, because you cannot do chest x-ray every day. So many of the time, their physiotherapy will be based on chest x-ray, which was done 2 or 3 days ago. Whereas lung ultrasound, you can do immediately before and after. So in that way, they have made a lot of publication, and they have been able to show that using that, they have been able to improve their outcome with chest physiotherapy. The other thing you can do is use for doing a percutaneous tracheostomy, which we do regularly in our unit. This is reduced diaphragmatic excursion. So basically here, we have used the abdominal probe. You're looking at the diaphragm. You are doing a M mode, and you are looking at the movement of the diaphragm, and the vertical displacement is what you are looking for. Up to more than 1 centimeter is normal. If this vertical displacement is less than 1 centimeter, it means that the patient has got a reduced chest excursion. So probably that is the reason why the patient is not able to wean from the ventilator. Other useful thing we have found with this is if a patient has a collapsed lung on one side, you will see that on that side, the chest excursion will be less compared to the other side. And we have been able to diagnose collapsed lung many times with this. This is what I told about diaphragm thickness. For this, you need to use a linear probe, high frequency probe, because it is proximal structure. And you need a very high resolution to measure the diameter. You measure the diameter and you see if it is again less than 1 millimeter, it means the patient has got a diaphragmatic thinning. And there is another thing called a thickening fraction, where the thickest diameter and thinnest diameter at the same place you will measure, and you thickest diameter minus thinnest diameter divided by thickest diameter times 100 will give you the thickening fraction. And if it is between 15% and 25%, it means the patient has got a normal diaphragmatic function. If it is less than 15%, it means the diaphragm dysfunction is present. If it is more than 25%, it means that the diaphragm is working very hard. If whatever ventilator setting you have put, it is not enough. So, use of lung ultrasound has gone beyond what we were using 10 years ago. And this is, as I explained to you before, there is some lung atelectasis here. After the physiotherapy, you repeat it again to see if they have disappeared. And this is the last part of my talk, use of ultrasound for tracheostomy. You will be able to use ultrasound to identify the structure of the trachea. This part is larynx, and these are tracheal rings. One tracheal ring, second tracheal ring, third tracheal ring. Like that, you'll be able to identify the structures while performing tracheostomy. The other useful thing is you can identify blood vessels, which can save you a lot of difficulties later. You will be able to see whether there are blood vessels or not wherever you want to go. And you will also be able to see what is the extent of that blood vessel, and also whether it's artery or vein, whether it's collapsible or not collapsible, and also whether it is in the central or it is slightly peripheral. We routinely do tracheostomy under ultrasound. We don't use bronchoscopy. I have not used bronchoscopy for more than 7 years now while performing tracheostomy, because I find that lung ultrasound helps me more than the bronchoscopy. I can see that what is the structure of the trachea, larynx, and all that. I can go into a specific tracheal ring. I can identify the blood vessels, and I can even avoid the blood vessels and do even in most difficult cases, even those patients with a short neck. Once you put the ultrasound, you see that difficult tracheostomy becomes a very easy tracheostomy, because you are able to see at least 2 tracheal rings, and that's more than enough. And about this injury of the posterior wall, which can be identified with the bronchoscopy, we have not seen that as a problem at all. And there are some publications which have also shown that using bronchoscopy will identify that if a patient has got a posterior tracheal wall injury, it will not prevent it. You know, what will prevent is how carefully you do it. So even though we don't use bronchoscopy, we have not found any problems with the posterior tracheal wall injury. And we feel it has made our whole experience better and the whole procedure safer. Okay, so this, for example, blood vessel is right in the middle from top to bottom. This patient, you cannot do tracheostomy, percutaneous tracheostomy. You didn't have to go there. You will do a surgical tracheostomy where they will open it, where they will tie this blood vessel, they will pull it to one side, and they'll be able to do the tracheostomy. So in that way, you can avoid catastrophe by using the ultrasound. So to summary, lung ultrasound is a useful tool for assessment of critically ill patients. The main uses as per that study is pneumonia, pneumothorax, pleural effusion, and alveolar interstitial syndrome, where there is a strong grade A recommendation made after a review of the literature. Nowadays, I feel COVID pneumonia can be included in this as well. Unfortunately, I was not able to put some slides. We are doing a study in our hospital. We have reviewed about 50 patients prospectively who we suspected might have COVID pneumonia based on the clinical features. And we were comparing a lung ultrasound finding with a CT scan. And as per the Bland-Altman plot, we found a very good correlation. We feel that a lung ultrasound in some circumstances can replace CT scan as well, and we are hoping to publish that very soon. So for COVID pneumonia as well, lung ultrasound can be useful, and now we are using it for some other things as well, not only for COVID pneumonia, for looking at the diaphragmatic excursion, looking at the diaphragm thickness, for weaning, for recruitment, and then, as I explained, for tracheostomy. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shetty. That was an outstanding presentation in such a short time. You've covered a wide variety of topics related to lung pathology. The one question that I would like to ask is, can you distinguish between Omicron and Delta COVID pneumonia with the ultrasound?
Right now, I think there is not much evidence. First of all, in India, for example, we will not know which patient has got Omicron and which patient doesn't, because not all the patients are tested for Omicron. There might be some actually, but I think we'll have to wait for some time.
All right, agreed. Second thing is, have you used ultrasound to do a surgical airway during a cannot intubate, cannot ventilate situation?
Yes, actually, it's a very good question. We had a personal experience. One patient who was in HDU had a HD catheter inserted, but unfortunately, there was a bleeding after that, and a patient was rushed to ICU with the airway obstruction, and we were not able to intubate, and we had to call we were not able to do the tracheostomy ourselves because it was completely displaced, and we had to call a ENT surgeon urgently to do the emergency surgical tracheostomy, and even they were not able to identify where was the trachea. And we were able to do the ultrasound and show them the trachea is here, and then with lots of difficulty they were able to do the tracheostomy, and the patient was discharged 2 days later. So it was really a successful procedure.
I'm sure that you had some way of keeping him oxygenated till
fortunately the oxygenation we were able to maintain, but it was it was a very dynamic situation. Patient was getting more and more obstructed as the minutes passed. So it was a very stressful situation as well. Fortunately,
Now I'm requesting the audience to ask any questions they might have. This is a newer, tool that's used routinely now in ICUs, and it's becoming increasingly used in the operating room. So it's a good way to actually tell whether you have intubated one lung versus having the tube in the middle of the trachea. So it's better than auscultation, especially in infants and young children, where the distance between the carina and bronchus is very small.
Yes. Please go ahead.
Yes, somebody is asking a question, please.
Yeah, sir, could you narrate about post-operative drain management? How can we guide it with ultrasound?
I think probably Dr. Bellani may be the best person for that. You know, pleural effusion or any collection or lung ultrasound is a very useful tool. You'll be able to even quantify how much fluid is there. Having said that, you know, when you do a lung ultrasound, it's a two-dimensional assessment. And what you actually want is a three-dimensional. But having said that, even with that limitation, usually if there is a 10 centimeter of or 1 centimeter for that matter of fluid, it means probably the patient has got about 100 ml of fluid. Like that, you know, if it is 2 centimeters, it's 200, 3 centimeters, 300. In that way, you'll be able to identify whether there is a significant collection or no, not significant collection. Based on that, you can decide how long to keep the drain. But probably Dr. Bilani is a better person. I think I don't deal with those, to that extent. Ours is usual pleural effusion or hemothorax after trauma. In cardiothoracic surgery, yeah, I think use it more.
I think for our infants, you can see a minimum of 25 cc's in the lungs. But older patients, maybe Muralidhar, do you have any experience?
Sir, can I answer? This is Dr. Ratan.
Yeah.
Carry on. Yeah, I do a lot of echoes looking for pleural effusion in adult cardiac surgical patients. And in case patient is not draining much and the echo doesn't show much effusion, if it is less than 100-150 ml of effusion in an adult patient in the pleura, sometimes I just go ahead and take out the drains. But in case there's a big effusion, which is not draining, then it becomes tricky. Maybe we'll have to reposition the tube or drain it in case a patient is getting affected because of the pleural effusion. But generally, less than 500 in an adult patient, it doesn't affect the oxygenation and the breathing of the patient.
Very good. The one important thing that Rajesh Shetty pointed out was you can actually do dynamic evaluation, especially during chest physiotherapy. So it might be a good tool for patients with cystic fibrosis who are getting that vibration therapy of the chest to see how effective it is working and how long they should do the chest vibrations. So that's something that we need to consider for the future.
Yes.
So Dr. Srinivas.
Yeah. May I ask one query, please?
Yes.
We do a lot of intraoperative transesophageal echocardiography. Does it help in lung ultrasound by any way intraoperatively? Like we can see the pleural effusion as you have mentioned, but any other usefulness of intraoperative TE in this matter? Do you have any experience on that? Because the lung can be visualized with the transesophageal echo as well.
There are no publications on that. I don't do TE on my own actually, so probably others. Our colleagues are probably better suited to answer this question, I think. But if you can see lungs with TE, then it means probably whatever we are saying with the other probes, you may be able to see with the TE as well, similar to transesophageal echocardiography and transesophageal echocardiography. Similar thing might be there, but there is no publication. So probably that is one area people should explore, I think.
I can just offhand tell that with TE, the amount of lung we see is very limited, whereas with transthoracic, you can scan the entire lung, both posteriorly and anteriorly, whereas with TE, it's very limited amount, so only the pleural effusions and whatever pathology is there at that part of the lung, we might be able to see, but we'll be missing out on the anterior portions and lateral portions of the lung.
Yeah,
that's my feeling about it. We have not tried it out actually.
There will be some air between the lung and the esophagus, I think, isn't it? And if there is just air, the lung ultrasound will not go through to the lungs. So probably that may be another reason why you may not see much of lung. I feel I'm not an expert in transesophageal esophageal echocardiography. But it may not be a good tool, I feel, but I don't have any experience.
It's very limited. The application will be very limited. That's my humble feeling.
Dr. Srinivasan, do you have
sir,
any
can I just add?
Dr.
Ratan. Can I just add? Yeah, so I just wanted to tell a recent case where we had totally wiped out right-sided chest X-ray. There were a lot of plasters. When the echo technicians came and did an echo, they mentioned that there was hardly any effusion. The limitation there was the lot of plaster with the drain taken out, and the echo technician probably didn't care to remove the plaster and then check the ultrasound. It was actually a massive pleural effusion, which we were able to drain and help the patient. So you have to make sure that the limitations because of the plasters and the dressings is taken care. Don't hesitate to remove the plasters in the post-operative patients.
Absolutely, absolutely. Surgical dressings and even surgical emphysema may interfere with transthoracic imaging. Yes, that's a good point.
Yes,
fully agreed.
Doctor, yes, Muralidhar, can I ask?
Yes, yes. Dr. Belani is the chairperson. You can ask him and he will certainly...
Yeah, go ahead, go ahead.
It was a beautiful, beautiful presentation, very practical, because I had heard many lectures on lung ultrasound and there were blue protocol and flap sign and this and that. But for us, this is very practical. And about this cardiac OPD detection of multiple number of B lines, I'm practicing it actually. And I am guiding the treating cardiologist or a surgeon that you have to reduce the diuretic or increase the diuretic as per the line number of lines. It was beautifully explained by the speaker. I just wanted to ask, is there any difference between number of lines if you use the probes, different probes like curvilinear or other probe, is there any difference in diagnosing the severity of the fluid congestion? Yes,
there is a difference. Mm-hmm. And even in the same probe, depending on what setting you have, it can change as well. So it is very important. It's a very good question, actually. Two important points you have raised. One of them is this, that it is important that with the same setting and same probe, you assess again. Repeat assessment has to be with the same probe and with the same setting. Because if you change the probe or change the settings, the number of B lines will be different. So it may not actually reflect the patient's condition.
Okay.
Dr. Rajesh already pointed out that with the micro probe more than 3 and with curvilinear probe more than 6 is indicative of pulmonary congestion. Yes. Is that right, Rajesh?
That's correct, yes. So it is important that you use the same probe for a serial assessment.
Right, right.
And the other thing, and I'm glad you mentioned about blue protocol. You know, I purposely, you know, missed the blue protocol. Blue protocol is produced by Daniel Lichtenstein. You know, I'm a great fan of Daniel Lichtenstein, but I don't think blue protocol is fit for purpose. You know, like any of these sort of FAST and all those protocol, the main purpose of this blue protocol is it is designed to make sure that you know, it is done fast, so that you don't waste much time and you are able to make a diagnosis. And another is even new novices can use it. I feel a blue protocol serves the first purpose, that you know, you can make a diagnosis very quickly by just putting the probe in 8 different places within 1 minute. You'll be able to make a diagnosis. But the second purpose is not served. You know, it is not useful for novices. You have to be highly experienced just to put 8 times the probe in different parts of the lung and make a diagnosis. For novices, I don't think it is useful at all. So I feel it doesn't serve the purpose, and that's why I don't use blue protocol, and I don't recommend anyone to do the blue protocol as well. I feel it is better to go for the diagnosis and say whether this diagnosis is there or not. If that patient has a pneumothorax, whether the patient has a pleural effusion, whether the patient has a pneumonia or even COVID pneumonia, rather than saying A profile and B profile and getting confused with that.
Very good suggestion. Because then we get confused and ultimately we end up doing, you know, all wrong things.
Yes. Yeah.
And another one more question I would like to ask. If the bases are having more B lines and upper portion of thorax is not having, so isn't it at par with the basal crypts or something like that?
So again, you have to always take the clinical context into account.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
Just ultrasound is not useful. It has to be interpreted on the background of the overall other you know, information you have. Having said that, you know, usually lung ultrasound, one of the things it will help you is, for example, increase in B lines. If it is bilateral, it means it is more of a disease which is affecting both lungs. for example, pleural effusion, not pleural, pulmonary edema, ARDS, failure, and things like that. Whereas if it is in only one part, it is only one part of the lung is getting affected. So for example, pneumonia, there will be increased B-line in only one part of the lung, not in both part of the lung, unless it is a severe pneumonia going on to ARDS. And like that, in basis, apart from increased B-line, I would be looking for other features as well. For example, is there a consolidation or is there a subpleural shedding? If other features are there, then I would say that, okay, that part of the lung has got a pneumonia on top of that. If there are no such things, it is only increased B-lines with non-dynamic bronchograms, then I would say that probably this is just a bibasal atelectasis, which is a normal finding, especially as you know, even after anesthesia, even after a few minutes of anesthesia, patients will start developing atelectasis of the lung. So it is a very common finding in hospitalized patients to see an increased B-lines in the basis. And that is a normal finding, unless your clinical evaluation suggests otherwise, and you have other features of other lung diseases as well.
Excellent.
Yes.
And I have one more question.
Thank you.
Can I ask one more query, please?
Please.
Proceed.
Please go ahead.
Are you unmuted?
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. Please tell your name also.
I'm Dr. Aparna Purohit, sir. We work in a small town, Sangli.
Okay.
So, we have operated a case of constrictive pericarditis. Today is a post-operative day 8. And patient is having nearly 800 drain on each side, which is serous and yellowish in color. So, how do we go about evaluating it, or does ultrasound play any role?
Ultrasound will play only to confirm whether there is a pleural effusion or not, collection is not, and what is the extent of it. Further evaluation, I think my other colleagues are better suited to answer. I think you may have to do a pleural tap and take a sample and send for analysis and things like that. Ultrasound may not help. One of the things it might help is whether it's a transudate or exudate. Having said that, an ultrasound is not the tool of choice to make that diagnosis. In exudate, you will see that there is some admixture of other things in the fluid, whereas if it is a transudate, it will be a clear fluid. But to say for sure whether it's an exudate, you still have to aspirate some sample and send. But in specifically with your case patient, I don't have much experience. I would leave it to the other panelists.
Pleural fluid, ma'am?
Yeah.
Was it pleural fluid or was it cardiac fluid, pericardial fluid?
See, all the three drains are in place and both side drains are draining 700 to 800 ml for last 2 days. The left hand is also having swelling. We are suspecting a chylothorax also. We have sent fluid for analysis, but then we are not able to diagnose it yet.
I think as Dr. Shetty said, the ultrasound will only tell you the anatomical changes that are taking place, but pathological findings have done by the lab medicine, and you have to do that, because here you'll just see the anatomy. You'll see whether there's more fluid in the pleural space or whether there's less fluid in the pericardial space. That's all you can use it for. You can't make a pathological diagnosis.
I agree with that. Dr. Srinivas, do you want to say anything on this issue?
Yeah, no, exactly, because we cannot make the pathological diagnosis with ultrasound. Basically, we can quantify the fluid. If there is a bleeding, either clots or fibrinous strands, they can be identified. But otherwise, diagnosing the pathology will be done only in the laboratory. May not be possible with the ultrasound.
Right, right.
Okay.
There are
Let's see if there are any other people having any questions.
Can I discuss? Dr. Kumar, yes. Can I discuss something?
Just wait. Let's see if there are any other questions.
There are two questions. One is, what is the probe position for delineating pleural effusion? What is the probe position for delineating pleural effusion?
What I would say is that fluidal collector and most dependent part. To drain it, you want it to be in the most dependent part, and you can see what is the extent. So I would sit the patient up, or you know, slightly propped up position, and then do the lung ultrasound and see where exactly there is the biggest pocket of fluid, so that you can go there. You know, in about 10 years ago, when I was in London, we used to do a very wrong practice, I feel now, where radiologists used to come and mark a site for you know, fluid, where to put the you know, the drain, and they will go, and 2-3 hours later we will do it, and we may not be doing it in the same position where you know, the radiologist had done. Now that we are doing it ourselves, we find that it is much better for us. You know, you position the patient as you would position when you are putting a drain, and then you do the lung ultrasound, see where is the biggest pocket, and you put the your drain there.
Yeah, there is one other question about post-COVID sequel coming for cardiac surgery. We have found lung adhesions. It's very difficult to drain this loculated effusion.
Yes.
What's your comment on this?
It is a difficult condition, actually. You know, wherever you put the drain, it may not drain completely. I would, you know, initially I will try to drain it with, you know, putting a drain itself. And I'll put it in whichever is the biggest pocket, you know, I can see. Having said that, it may not completely resolve the situation. The patient may need other you know, interventions, including pleurodesis or even you know, your VATS or you know, thoracotomy and all those things.
Yeah, I think you'll need to break those adhesions. Mm-hmm. It'll require an extensive operation first, mm-hmm. before you do the cardiac surgery, unless the cardiac surgery is urgent.
Thank you.
Sir, may I?
Yes, please. Yes.
Sir, that is my question. I'm Dr. Nagaraj.
Yes, yes.
This is, sir, these are actually post-COVID sequelae which has come for CABG, cardiac bypass surgery. So we don't try to release the lung adhesions, you know, extensively, and we just release it as much as we can just put a dependent drain. And in the post-operative, we found that there are some collections which are still there, and we were not able to tap them.
I think your radiologist might be able to help, I suppose, you know, to see where is the biggest pocket and put one drain just there. And this is my
suggestion. The interventional radiologist. Interventional radiologist.
What is your suggestion,
sir? No, sir. I mean, this was very difficult, sir. Actually, we have found some 4 or 5 patients like this, sir. Basically, we were very difficult to drain. We tried to do some positional changes, and we were trying to drain some part of it and put a suction catheter inside the pleural drain, and then we will try to take out some clots. But it was slightly a Herculean task to actually drain them, sir. It is a very difficult condition. Is a lung ultrasound would try to do something or change the whole scenario? Or that is what I need to know. Because
these are some of the these are some of the new problems we are coming across thanks to COVID, you know, newer problems and newer challenges, and I'm sure the ultrasound will be able to play a role. One of the areas I could see is that you can see where is the biggest collection and try to put a drain there. But these are the things I think we'll be facing as we go forward. These, and probably there will be more new problems such as well.
What was the correct for this case?
Sorry.
What was the COREX for this case, and did you have any problem with oxygenation in these cases?
No, sir, no problem with oxygenation. And they're post-COVID sequelae, sir, coming for there was the COREX was absolutely fine. The post-COVID sequelae.
How long after the COVID?
2 months, sir.
How long after the COVID?
2 months.
2 months?
Yeah.
Okay. And did they still have
extensive additions?
Did they have cytokines?
Good morning, sir. Sir, good morning. Can I ask one question?
The CRP was normal.
Dr. Muralidhar, I am Dr. V. Kumar from Delhi. Can I ask one question?
Oh, sure. Please go ahead.
Sir, is it possible to see the bronchus also with the lung ultrasound, left bronchus or right bronchus? Sometimes in the cardiac surgery, we have to see the position of condition of the bronchus due to the pressure of the left atrium or sometimes like that. Is it possible? Yeah. That's my question.
I think it is not possible. Having said that, you know, I have missed one part, which probably I can try to include now. The ultrasound is used for during intubation, difficult intubation, for example, and many of the anesthetists start their intubation process with the ultrasound probe placed in the neck. so that they can see the trachea and esophagus. And if you know the ET tube is going into the esophagus, you'll be able to recognize it immediately, so that you can take it out. You don't have to wait for the entitled CO2 and all that to recognize that patient has a esophageal intubation. And also, in a difficult situation, you would have identified the cricothyroid membrane, so that emergency cricothyrotomy can be done as well. For this purpose, to identify the trachea, identify the esophagus, identify the esophageal intubation, and emergency cricothyrotomy, the ultrasound is used. Bronchus, I think, probably is difficult because you know to access to that with the transthoracic probe might be difficult. There will be a lot of air column between your probe and the bronchus. And because of that, the images may not be very clear is what I would think. I haven't seen any you know literature on that.
Actually, it's very difficult to identify the bronchus per se. Because as he has mentioned, the presence of air will make the ultrasound difficult to pass through. So usually trachea can be discovered with the help of ultrasound, but I have no experience of detecting bronchus with the help of ultrasound. Even both the transthoracic as well as transesophageal echo, transesophageal echo may show the position of the bronchus per se, but we cannot see the detailed structure of the bronchus with the echocardiography or with the surface ultrasound as well. So bronchus may be difficult.
I agree.
Generally, we do with the fiber optic, but it is sometimes not available. That's why I was asking if non-invasive procedure, is it possible? Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think we are close to 10 o'clock.
Can I ask the last question? I want to discuss one case with Dr. Rajesh. This was a lady who came postpartum in our clinic, and she was having breathlessness. So I did her echo, which was normal. So they were suspecting postpartum cardiomyopathy, which was ruled out. But when I looked at her diaphragm, her diaphragmatic movements were very, very weak. So have you come across such postpartum diaphragmatic weakness, or how to go about it?
No, I haven't got experience of that. Most of the diaphragmatic assessment we do is for those patients who are having a weaning difficulty, who have got a diaphragmatic atrophy or diaphragmatic
in ICU.
Yes. The patients coming immediately. What we use it for to see whether whatever ventilatory support we are giving is adequate or not. But to make a diagnosis of a postpartum diaphragmatic dysfunction, so far I have not done. Some you know nerve injury causing phrenic nerve palsy, causing diaphragmatic dysfunction, we have been able to diagnose. But postpartum related diaphragm dysfunction, I have got no experience. I don't know if there is any literature on that as well. I'll have a look. It's a good question.
Thank you. And one more
is this a multiple gestation or is it?
No. She was a young girl. I think she was primary.
Is it bilateral or just unilateral?
Bilateral. The moment she used to sleep, she used to feel breathless. So anyone would think of cardiac origin. Like postpartum cardiomyopathy, but her echo was absolutely normal. And she did have diaphragmatic, severely depressed diaphragmatic movements.
I think probably physiologically as well. Diaphragmatic movement, I think, because of the presence of the uterus and the fetus itself.
Yes.
How much of that is abnormal, I'm not sure.
And another thing which I observed in our clinic was post-COVID, there were many patients having reduced diaphragmatic movement, to which we have been advising them abdominal breathing, practice of abdominal breathing. Can you comment on that? Whether we are right or I don't know how to go about it. Post-COVID diaphragmatic weakness. Because otherwise also they advise abdominal breathing. So in all these physiotherapies, they do advise abdominal breathing, which has come on the net all over the, you know, in many areas, that to avoid COVID or to face COVID, you know, efficiently, one should use abdominal breathing. That is why I'm asking you this.
One thing I suggest is you can do a study in your place to show whether this diaphragmatic excursion is improving with those exercises, because then you have a baseline, you have a standard probe, and you have a standard position. So you should do a study on that and demonstrate that it's effective. That will be useful information.
Yes, I'll certainly do that. But comments?
We can. We are past 10 o'clock. I think we have come to the end of this session.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. And thank you, Dr. Srinivasan, Dr. Muralidhar, and all the others who participated.
Thank you, Dr.
And we will stay in touch. New Year.
Yes, I would like to thank Dr. Belani, Dr. Srinivas, and Dr. Rajesh Shetty for being with us. And all the participants, please join us again tomorrow afternoon and next Sunday. We will have interesting discussions. Thank you so much. On behalf of FCA, I would like to thank all the participants and have a great Sunday. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.